However, in addition to the mechanical description of proteins for simulation throttling, there's been many other attempts of different levels of descriptions. And here's just an overview of some of these. And basically, you can divide them into two dimensions. One is actually how many residues you have, how many atoms you have per residue. So you can really see if you look at the Amber ESP algorithm, that's molecular mechanics. Basically, then you have this, you have a detailed description of atoms. But you could principle use electron protons, but that has hardly ever been used in this case because it's too complicated and doesn't really add anything. And then you have methods that are kind of have many simple thing. We have one atom, one ball per each residue. But often you have, sometimes you have maybe one residue and a side chain, or sometimes you have a few sides, few atoms and side chains. So this is from the extended atom. For instance, that is used in the Rosetta model. You have actually the backbone, and then you have one or two residues for the side chains, depending on the size of side chains. So a simplified model. So, but often you have like, it's often you want to have something in this kind of side chains. That's a good predictions. The other dimension is actually how do you describe it? You don't have to be in a continuous space, because actually, you know that for instance, the bond length between two atoms is very, it's quite fixed. It does just vibrate slightly. So you don't have, if you reduce that, if you keep it fixed, you have a lower dimension. So you can work, for instance, as I said, as described before, most of the rotations of the backbone happens in the phi psi angles. You can basically say that we only have two dimensions for describing the backbone residues, which is four residues, which we need with three residues, we need nine dimensions otherwise. So you can reduce it from nine to two by just having phi psi angles. And even phi psi angles is actually not even distributed, only some part of phi psi space that is populated. So you can even do it as fragments. You can also keep some parts of it, so you reduce it from almost one more dimension. So the fragment description is quite common, that you use actually some parts of proteins and you copy it. But also, it used to be at least earlier, and still like since exists, some lattice models that basically reduces the space to fixed points in the three-dimensional coordinates. So you have like, it's the thing as a square lattice, we can go up and down the square lattice. But you also have lattices that are have other dimensions of diamond lattices and more detailed lattices that are thinking that. The advantage of lattices is that you can do calculations extremely fast. You can do a lot of pre-calculations. The disadvantage, of course, you can't ever really describe the protein exactly. So nowadays they are not that popular. And as discussed earlier, of course, the atoms. So the other problem, of course, with this is except the description of the model is that you need to have the energy for them. And actually, one problem is that actually we even the best models are not very accurate. They always have small errors because they sum up. If you have 100 residues and you have half kcal energy error in each residue pair of direction, I mean, each residue you have 50 kcal energies error. And the stability of a protein is maybe only 5 to 10 kcal per mole. So it's not very stable. So it's a fine balance between folding and non-folding for most proteins. So if you sum up all these thousands of terms, you're going to end up with errors. So you need to very carefully balance all these errors against each other and do simulations and tests and tests and tests. The other problem, as I said before, is water. And even if you want to do a good MD simulation, you need to have water. And even there are different water models and none of them are perfect. And there's been a lot of development of this lately, but that's another story. But often if you do simulation folding, you want to ignore the water. And you have your sort of implicit explicit water model. And when you want to use implicit water models, that basically describes the water's continuum. However, they're still quite slow, the accurate ones, so they take too long time to calculate. So you need to make some simple models. The explicit water models are actually not that slow to calculate, but they need time to equilibrate, because you need to let the water equilibrate around the position. The other problem is often that if you do this kind of non-MD simulation, as I said before, is we have to take care of entropy. Because if we do a minimization, we're not discovering entropy. And if you do simulation and emulation, we have to take our entropy, but we don't do that here. So we have to somehow compensate the entropic term here. And of course, then we have a problem with overlap. Basically, atoms will not overlap, and we get stuck in local barriers. So basically, we need to do that in some smart ways. So the questions are, is there some ways to get around this? And what has come up lately, or lately in the last 15, 20 years, is that we can actually divide this part into two problems. We can divide it into a local problem, that is some, what is the preference of a residue, so like a few residues together, and maybe a helix together, things like that, and then we have a global problem. The global problem is dominated by hydrophobicity. We know that proteins in general are hydrophobic inside and hydrophilic on the outside. So we can basically say that proteins should be dominated by hydrophobicity, should optimize hydrophobicity. But of course, we cannot allow overlap and things like that. We cannot let proteins, we cannot destroy the secondary structures. But the local preference is the preference being secondary structures. And the solution there is that we basically do the division twice. We do search of local fragments, and then we have a set of fragments that describes the possible local conformations, then we try to combine these together. And this is what is done in Rosetta and Frankfurt and other programs that we will describe in the next video.